Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. We are going to stand up and open up with hymn number 28, Good Christian Friends Rejoice.
I'm trying to.
Please be seated. At this time, I would like to invite the Lowry family to come forward to lead us in the lighting of our Advent wreath.
We light these candles as a sign of the coming light of Christ. Advent means coming. Watch and wait for Christ's coming, remembering the promises of God with prayer. We light this candle in hope. Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. We are preparing ourselves for the days when nations shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. We light this candle for peace. Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. We light this candle in joy. Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing.
It's not lighting.
I don't know what's going on. Pretend.
Okay, use y'all's imagination.
Here we go.
Ha ha, there we go. Will you please join me in the Advent prayer as it is printed in your bulletin? Almighty God, you have made us and all things to serve you. Now prepare the world for your rule. Come quickly to save us so that wars and violence shall end and your children may live in peace, honoring one another with justice and love through Jesus Christ, who lives in power with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
We are now going to stand and continue worshiping with Midnight Clear, a love song.
Please be seated. Well, good morning. It's great to see all of you here in the house of our God and King on this, the day that the Lord has made. Let us truly rejoice and be glad in it. Well, if you're paying attention to the Advent wreath, we're three candles down already, which means Christmas is very, very soon. Hope everyone's got most of your Christmas shopping done, because the stores are getting emptier by the day. So you better hurry up and get it done. But I'm glad you decided to come here and worship in this Advent season with us here at Cherokee Presbyterian. And if you're a visitor here today, we want to first of all welcome you. We're glad you decided to worship with us today, dry here in the church while it's wet and raining outside. But we're glad you're here inside with us. And if you want to follow along with the service, anything you need to follow along is going to be printed right here in your bulletin. And if you're watching live or recorded, anything you need to know to follow along with the service will appear on the screen at the right time. Now, finally, I only have a few announcements today instead of a whole bunch because Christmas season is coming to a close, but would like to bring a few to your attention. First of all, the Giving Tree. If you got a tag for the Giving Tree for some presents, we need those in as soon as possible. So as soon as you have those ready, if you could get us into the church, maybe today or early this week if possible. Also, our cookie sales are done, so we have the cookies for you to pick up. They're going to be outside, but if you could either talk to Liz or Cecilia to pick up your order so we'll be able to make sure everybody gets theirs and they're done in an organized fashion. So Cecilia and Liz will be back there in the hallway for you, so if you could just pick your orders up from either one of them. I mean, next Sunday is going to be Christmas Eve, so that is the 24th, which means we're going to have two services on Christmas Eve. We're going to have our normal Sunday morning worship service, and then in the evening we're going to have our carols and candles, the candlelight service we always do on Christmas Eve. Because of these two services, we're going to do things a little bit differently on Sunday morning. So for the morning of the 24th, we're going to have a shorter worship service, but in the midst of that service, we're going to do a service project. We've got some gifts that we've collected for the children at Thornwell, and also some gift bags we're going to make for the kids from Los Diques. It's a squatter community in Costa Rica that we visited this summer. And we're going to provide the stuff to go in the bags. What we just need you to do is come, and we're going to have some tables set up, and then part of our worship service, we're going to pack these bags and get the gifts ready for these children in need. So it'll be, I think, a great way to worship our God and King and just to show thankfulness for the abundance he's given us by preparing this in our worship service itself to give back. I would ask you to bring, if you're coming that day, a bag of candy, and preferably one that will not melt if it travels from Lexington to Costa Rica. So like candy canes or something like that. You get a little bit of chocolate for the kids at Thornwell, but preferably non-chocolate, non-melting candies. So if you just show up for yourself, ready to serve, and bring a bag of candy, that's all we need for the morning service of the 24th. And the evening, of course, is going to be at 5 p.m. at our traditional candlelight Christmas Eve service. And we'd love for all of you to be there. It's always a very meaningful and one of my favorite services of the year. And I think that's all the announcements I have for today. And so now I would like to ask the children of the church to come forward and join Nell for our moment for children.
Okay. Are y'all ready for? Okay. Come on. There you go. I don't think my mic is on. Am I on? Hello? About now.
Good morning. There we go. How are y'all this morning?
Good.
Are you getting excited about Christmas?
Yes.
Really excited. I know you did. Okay. And you don't have school this week, so that's good.
All right, but this is the time of the year that we need to remember what Christmas is all about. And it's all, y'all notice right here, okay, give me one second. What have we got right here?
Santa
praying at Jesus. So what does that tell us? That Jesus is the reason for the season. Yes, ma'am. That's right. Okay. I'm going to read you a prayer that I've been reading for the past few years, and it's all about our praying for the reason for the season. But Santa wrote this prayer. On Christmas Eve the other night, I saw the most amazing sight. For there beneath the Christmas tree was Santa kneeling on his knee. His countenance was different than that all-familiar jolly grin. His head was bowed with hand to breast and slightly tucked into his vest. For there in a nativity was Jesus and his family. As I heard him start to pray, I listened close to what he'd say. Lord, you know that you're the reason I take such pleasure in this season. I don't want to take your place, but just reflect your wondrous grace. I hope you'll help them understand I'm just an ordinary man who found a way to do your will by finding kids with needs to fill. But all those centuries ago, there was no way for me to know that they would make so much of me and all the gifts beneath the tree. They think I have some hidden power granted at the midnight hour, but it is my love for you inspiring all the things I do. So when they begin to open gifts for which they have been hoping, may they give you all the glory, for you're the one true Christmas story. And then I found another one, and this one is a Christmas letter from Jesus. So listen closely to what Jesus has to say. When you look for me at Christmas, you won't need a special star. I'm no longer just in Bethlehem. I'm right here where you are. You may not be aware of me amid the celebrations. You'll have to look beyond the stores and all the decorations. But if you take a moment from your list of things to do to close your eyes and say a prayer, I'm waiting here for you. You're the one I want to be with. You're the reason that I came. And you'll find me in the stillness where I'm whispering your name. Don't you just love that? I mean, it's Jesus telling us from his point of view, and then we have Santa Claus. So let's remember, oh, it's fun with the decorations. I love Christmas decorating, my favorite time of the year. It's fun with the presents, but keep in mind that he is the reason for our season. And as you go out the door, Mr. Norman's standing back there, and I have a pencil, and on here it says Happy Birthday Jesus, and then a little stocking that's got something on it that you can put on the tree. So I want you to take these things, but remember, all at the same time, let's say what the reason is. Jesus is the reason for the season. Y'all did not do that right. Let's go again. One, two, three. Jesus is the reason for the season. Okay. Y'all have a good week. Who wants to pray us out today? Okay, Lily.
Dear Jesus, we thank you for all our gifts and praying for you and listening really close to us. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen.
Very good. All right, y'all, we'll go back and sing this morning.
In this season, we truly remember all that Christ has done for us and all the many ways that God shows us his love. And God shows us his love in that while we were still sinners, Christ came and he died for the ungodly, offering himself for the forgiveness of our sins. And to receive this forgiveness, all we need do is repent and confess our sins to him. So friends, let us come together and confess our sins, first in quiet reflection in our hearts and to God alone, and then together as it's printed in the bulletin, and this will be a responsive prayer. Let us pray. And now together. Lord, we come to you as your people, servants of Jesus Christ. For all the ways that we have fallen short of your commands. For all the times we have turned away from those in need. For all that we have spoken in anger and haste. For all the times we remain silent when we should speak out. For all the thoughts of anger and pride that we harbor within. For not trusting in you and your ways. For not loving others as we love ourselves. For not loving you with our whole heart, mind, and soul. Father, grant us your forgiveness and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Restore to us hearts made whole and wills that seek to obey your word. Christ Jesus, amen. Friends, hear the good news. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We are now going to stand and sing hymn number 2, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Please be seated. Our scripture passage today comes from the prophet Isaiah. We're looking at chapter 11, verses 1 to 9. This is one of the many places in Isaiah that predicts the advent or coming of our Lord Jesus. Before we read this, let's pause for a moment in prayer. Good and gracious Father, who has given us all that we have good in this life. And Lord, you have also given us your Spirit and your Word to direct us and guide us. Lord, we thank you for these gifts. And as we come before your Word today, we ask that your Holy Spirit would illuminate us and speak in our hearts and minds, that as we hear, that as we read, Lord, that we would understand your good and perfect will for us. Father, bless these words that I read today, Lord, these holy words of a holy God. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is the prophet Isaiah, chapter 11, verses 1 to 9. Listen now to the word of the Lord. There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion and the fattened calf together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So if you have never seen the movie The Princess Bride, you may be a little bit confused at my sermon title. I don't know if you've read your flash or the bulletin or the marquee out there by the road, but if you've never seen the movie, you're probably a little confused. And well, maybe if you have seen the movie, you still might be a little bit confused. But if you've never seen Princess Bride, first of all, I want to say you ought to be ashamed of yourself, okay? If you've never seen that movie, it is one of the best movies ever made, and you should make it a priority to see it as soon as possible if you've never seen The Princess Bride. Go, you need to see it. You need to. All right. You're losing out if you haven't seen it, I promise. But if you haven't seen it, or if you've forgotten a little bit, The Princess Bride is a story about is a young boy who is sick and home from school, and his grandfather comes to read him a book. And the name of the book is The Princess Bride. So as the grandfather's reading to the boy, we get to see the story played out in the movie. And every once in a while, the scene flashes back to the bedroom where the grandfather's reading to the boy, and the boy's arguing or objecting about something in the story. Usually he doesn't want to hear about the kissing parts, and he wants more of the action and adventure. But it's a lovely story. It's a wonderful, it's kind of a comedic little tongue-in-cheek take on a lot of the fairy tales. And in this story, the main character is this beautiful young woman by the name of Buttercup. And later she becomes Princess Buttercup. And she's in love with this poor farm boy named Wesley. And all Buttercup and Wesley want to do is to love each other and to share a life together, and to be free from all the troubles of the world. But you've got the evil prince. His name is Prince Humperdinck. And Prince Humperdinck, he keeps getting in the way of Buttercup and Wesley being together because he wants Buttercup for himself. And so you have all kinds of interesting conflict. There's chases, escapes. There's fights. You know, it's, like I said, great movie. But in the middle of the movie, I wouldn't call it the climax. Maybe they call it with the nadir, when you hit the bottom point. Humperdinck, Prince Humperdinck, kills Wesley. I'm sorry, that's a bit of a spoiler. But not really, because he's only mostly dead. And that also was a spoiler, I'm sorry. But he kills Wesley, and then the scene breaks back to the boy in the room with his grandfather. Because the boy's starting to get angry. He's confused, and he says, "Grandpa, what do you mean Wesley's dead? Wesley can't be dead." And he's got a good point. Wesley can't be dead. He's the hero of the story. You can't kill the hero of the story in the middle of the story. But the grandfather insists, "Yes, son, I'm sorry, Wesley's dead." And they get into a big argument, and finally the boy, in anger, he slams his fist to the bed, and he says, "Who kills Humperdinck? Who Someone's got to get him back. Someone's got to kill Humperdinck. Someone's got to perform the justice needed to make the story right. And the boy's even more upset to find out nobody kills Humperdinck. Humperdinck lives. Now, you can understand the boy's frustration. You can understand it completely. The bad guys aren't supposed to win. That's a terrible story. You violated a sacred law of movies making and storytelling. If I watch a movie, and at the end of the movie, the bad guys wins and the credit rolls, you've just wasted 2 hours of my life. I do not want to watch something where the bad guy wins. You've ruined my day. Sometimes the whole day's ruined when the bad guy ends up winning. Most of the time, thankfully, most of the movies get it right. Most of the movies get it right. The bad guy doesn't win, and the good guy comes out on top at the end. Ah, if only that were true in life. Yeah. If only we could say that in life, that the good guys always win and the bad guys always lose. That would be great, wouldn't it? Unfortunately, we don't live in that kind of world. And maybe that's the great appeal that movies have for us. Because in the movies, the good guys get to win. And maybe that's why we hate to see the bad guys win in movies, because we see it so often in real life. Time and time again, it seems like the greediest, the most ruthless, the cruelest people are the ones that end up on top. Time again, we see it always throughout our life. Sometimes it's the meanest guy at your office that ends up getting the best promotion. It's the biggest jerk at school that's the most popular and seems to have all the friends. And even in the world of politics, it seems the most ruthless are the ones that get ahead the most. Like for some reason, we're rewarding the worst habits among human beings. And you even look in any place where there's a lot of money, where there's a lot of fame, where there's a lot of power, it always attracts the worst kinds of people among our world. And even if someone gets caught, and they do get caught occasionally, I mean, you and I, we become jaded. We know not much is going to happen to them. Every time I hear a news story about a new politician that's been caught, there's the smoking gun. He's finally been caught in some wrongdoing. I don't care if it's the right or the left, the Democrat or Republican. I've come to the realization nothing's going to happen to him. Nothing's really going to happen to him. Oh, they might have to step down if it gets bad enough. But in a few years, you know, they're going to come right back. Everyone's going to forget it. And they're not going to get in any real trouble. They won't be prosecuted by the law. And every once in a while, even when you see them get prosecuted, they somehow get away with it. They've either got the right lawyer or they've got the right friend in the right place or they've got the right influence. And if they're connected high enough and somehow get prosecuted, you know what happens? They get a presidential pardon in a few years and it's like it never happened. Doesn't seem fair. Doesn't seem fair. It doesn't seem right. And you can easily share the frustration of that boy. Who kills Humperdinck? Who gets the Humperdincks of the world? Who's the one that goes after these people that they've been empowered to carry out justice in our world? And they've been given the power and the position and the prestige in order to be agents of justice in the world. But who goes after them when justice is required of what they've done? Too often, nobody. Too often they get away. And we see things like that happen and it makes us almost lose faith in life. That maybe what my mom said was right after all. And that life isn't fair. Well, as you know, we like to preach good news here. And that sounds like a lot of bad news. But I've got some good news for you. Because here in this Advent season, where we celebrate the coming of Christ into our world, We also celebrate when he brought us not just good news, but good news of great joy. And I got a great piece of good news for you today. The bad guys don't win. In the end of time, when it all comes together, the bad guys don't win. In fact, it's the good guys that win. And this isn't me just talking. This isn't me just making things up. God has promised us that the good guys will win. God has given us this promise several places in Scripture. Among them is the one that we read today. Today, what we read in Scripture, he gives us a peek of what the kingdom of God is going to look like when it is fulfilled finally, when God's work is finished and the kingdom of God is finished. And last week, we talked about it a little bit. We saw a little peek of the kingdom of God, and what we saw was political peace being brought to the earth. We talked about swords being beaten to plowshares and spears into pruning hooks and all that good stuff. There's not going to be war anymore. And what preceded that and made it possible was that everyone came to worship God and to obey His law and to obey His word. And today we see another peek into this kingdom, and we see once again a peace of God reigning in the world. But this is not just a political peace that we see today. This is an even more incredible kind of peace. What God has promised us today is the coming of the natural peace of the world. Is a peace that's going to go throughout all the natural world itself. And some extraordinary things are going to happen when peace ends up reigning over the natural world. It says stuff's going to happen like a wolf is going to lie down with a lamb. And these are two creatures that are you know, a wolf is a predator towards a lamb, but now they're going to be at peace and they're going to lie down to each other. Like a bear and an ox are going to lie down together. And lions are going to eat straw. Like non-predatorial animals. And they even said little kids are going to be playing with cobras. Little kids can play with cobras and they can stick their hand in the nest of poisonous snakes because it's not going to harm them. Like all the danger and all the harm that sometimes we worry about with nature, with what Alfred Tennyson called nature red in tooth and claw, is not going to be the law anymore. That we're going to be experiencing nature as it was good and peaceful as God intended it to be. And this is an incredible peace because, like I said, it's not just a political peace. This is a natural peace that's going to be coming over the world. And I want you to notice what brings this peace about. All right, God just doesn't just snap his fingers or clap his hands and make peace reign all over the earth. There is something very specific that happens that allows this peace to reign over the whole earth. And what happens is the justice of God. It's the justice of God. The justice of God is satisfied, and out of that, we get natural peace over the whole world. I want you, in the Scripture, you see that we read today that it is talking about Jesus. It's talking about the advent or the coming of Jesus. It started out saying that there's going to be a branch from the root of Jesse. And if you may remember, Jesse was the father of King David. So someone descended from the line of King David. And read the genealogies in Luke and in Matthew. We know Jesus descended from King David. So this is talking about Christ. This is going to be a righteous branch from the root of Jesse. Someone from King David. And he's going to reign in the place of his ancestor David. But the Spirit of God is going to be upon him in a powerful way. It's going to be a spirit of wisdom and a spirit of might. And out of that spirit, Jesus is going to bring justice into the world. He's going to bring a true justice into the world, and is not going to be like the justice of man. Because the justice of man is always flawed. And even in our system, and I got to say, I really think we try. I think we really try in this country today. And I think we've got probably the best justice system that I've seen anywhere else in the world. But even with all of our efforts, and even with this wonderful Constitution and the great laws that we have in place, even the best systems, you got to admit, they end up favoring the rich and the powerful. And it's almost something that you can't help. I mean, they always can get the best lawyers and sometimes afford whole teams of lawyers. They've always got the friends in the highest places. They always know how to work the system to their advantage. And those who don't know the system, those who can't afford the good lawyers, those who don't have the friends in high places, those don't know how to work the system, so often they were the ones that suffer from our system of justice. So we have the justice of man that is flawed, but the justice of Jesus is going to be different. This is what he says. I want y'all look at verse 3 at the prophecy we read today. And it says, he shall judge, he means Jesus, he shall judge not by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. See, he's not going to judge when he comes to bring justice. He doesn't judge like man does. It says he's not going to judge by what his eyes see. And what they mean by that, he's not going to be impressed by appearances. Someone can come in with the rich clothes, someone that's well-connected, and they know all the right people in all the right places. That's not going to come into Jesus' judgment at all. And it says he's not going to judge by what his ears hear. And I think that means he's not going to be swayed by eloquent arguments. He's not going to be swayed by technicalities of the law. He's not going to be persuaded by someone who can speak well and has a good grasp of the law. Says he's going to judge with righteousness. He's going to pass his judgment with equity. And when he does that, his judgments are going to favor the poor and the meek. It's those under our system who are least likely to get justice, even in the good systems. The ones who are overlooked, the ones who take the brunt of the system. But in Christ's judgments, they will receive a favorable judgment. But the wicked, the evildoers, the workers of greed and injustice, he says, with the breath of his lips, he will kill the wicked. That's meaning by the words he speaks, by the words that come out of his mouth, because when he speaks, he's going to pass judgment, and it's going to be a righteous judgment. And when he does so, the wicked of the earth will be no more. Now, I know that sounds kind of harsh. I know that sounds kind of harsh, but this is absolute necessity for the peace of God to reign in the world. It is his justice, it is his judgment that precedes the possibility that we can have peace in political peace or even peace within the natural order of the world. Because the reason why we don't have peace now, not just political peace, but even natural peace, the reason why we don't have it is because despite our best efforts, righteousness and justice do not reign in the world. It's greed. It's envy. It's anger. It's lust. It's ambition. It's rivalry. It's pride. These are what reign in the world. Without justice, there can be no peace on earth. Because without justice, these are the things that reign. Without justice, it is the evil of the world that will continue to exert their influence and reign in the earth. So it is only justice that can bring it to the end. We like to ask a lot why bad things happen in life. Why do they happen in life? Why this life that God made good, it even looked at it and called it good, why and how can it be corrupted by evil things? The answer is simple. It's evil people. Evil people doing evil things have corrupted this world from top to bottom. And the sin of man has become so complete that nature itself has become corrupt and filled with violence and danger in the earth. Now, I want to note, no, I'm not talking about specific acts of natural calamity. I don't think that a hurricane hits New Orleans because God is specifically punishing New Orleans, or a tornado hits Oklahoma because God is punishing Oklahoma. He may or may not be doing that. I don't have access to that kind of information. But these kinds of things happen because the whole natural order has been broken by the sinfulness of man. And now evil things happen. And evil things happen sometimes indiscriminately, even to the best among us. But when the justice of God is complete, there will be peace on earth. Not just peace between nations, not just peace between people, but peace between the people and the animals, and people in the natural world and animals between each other. It will be a peace of nature, which means there'll be no more famines, there'll be no more floods, no hurricanes or earthquakes or tornadoes. Or if they do happen, they'll have no casualty count. No one again will be mauled by a bear or killed by a plague. No more cancers. No more heart attacks. No more high cholesterol. You see, the justice of God will win. The justice of God will win out unto the world, and evil will not have the last word to shape our world. The justice of God will win, and the world will finally work exactly like it's supposed to. The good guys are going to win. The Humperdincks of the world will receive the judgment they have brought upon themselves. Now, I want you to be careful here, because this is not about revenge. This is not about revenge. This is not about getting back the people that have hurt us and done us wrong. There is no vindictiveness in what God is doing here, and there is no vindictiveness in Him. This is justice. This is the Lord's justice. This is the Lord's reckoning. This is taking all that is wrong and setting it to right. So who kills Humperdinck? Who kills the Humperdincks of the world? Who serves justice to those who escape the hand of earthly justice? Well, it's not us. It's very rarely us. Nor should this be our obsession. God warns us about this many times in Scripture. He warns us about revenge. He warns us about having a heart that just wants to get people back. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Judgment is mine, saith all God. And in all honesty, in all truth, if we were to carry out justice ourselves, you have to admit it, ours would just be as flawed as any we see here on earth. A critical part of our faith is believing in the justice of God. A key part of this good news that we believe in, that we love, that we preach and proclaim, is believing that God one day is going to set right everything that is wrong. And because of this, we can still believe in good. We can still trust in what is good and do what is good with a whole heart, knowing that God's justice is going to have the last word. And you don't have to be envious. You don't have to be jealous. You don't even have to be angry. Well, you have to be a little bit angry about evil people who seem to get away with it and never face punishment for what they do in their life, because His justice will reign in the end. The good guys are going to win. I'm going to leave you with these words from Psalm 37. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. Be not envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not yourself, it only tends to evil. Hear that right there. Fret not yourself, it only tends to evil. For the evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall inherit the land. In just a little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look carefully at his place, he will not be there. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. To God be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, will you pray with me? Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe. Father, we come to you today as a people who too often see injustice going unpunished. Lord, too often we see the evil of the world prosper. Too often, Lord, we see those who mock you and your ways and your law and even spurn your grace. Lord, too often those are the ones lifted to highest position and seem to be benefited and gifted more than any others. Father, first I pray that you forgive our unbelief and our lack of faith. Father, help us to believe, Lord, in your justice. Help us to believe, Lord, in the call of our life. Lord, help us to believe in what you have called good and told us is good. Father, give us hearts that never tire of doing good. Give us hearts that never tire of loving each other, Lord. Give us hearts that never tire of showing forgiveness and showing kindness and showing compassion even to those who hurt us. Father, we pray to you today that your justice be done. Father, we pray to you today that your justice be done throughout all the earth. Father, for the poor and for the meek, for those who are trodden down, Father, we pray that you give them justice and relief. For all those who suffer, Lord, for all those who hurt or in pain, Lord, because of the injustice of a broken world, Father, we pray you pour your love, your goodness, your patience, Lord, and also the promised reminder that the good of this earth will win one day. Help us to remember, Lord, that evil doesn't reign, that it is here but for a moment, Lord. Just a breath, Lord, like grass in the oven. Lord, a wind that passes us by and is gone again and forgotten forever. Help us, Lord, to believe in your promises, to believe in your grace, to hold fast to the good news and the great joy of Jesus Christ, our Savior. So, Father, we lift up to you, Lord, the prayers of a world that is lost too often in darkness. We pray peace between nations. We pray the cessation of all wars and violence upon our world, Lord. Father, we pray peace between ourselves and the natural world. We pray, Lord, the quick coming and return of your Son to our lives and to this world. Father, we lift up to you all those who need healing today. We lift up to you Marissa and Fred and Bill and Barbara and Dale and Ashley and Kay and Lindsay and Betty and Gloria. And pray, Father, you grant them healing and peace in body, soul, and spirit. We pray for all those who grieve today. We especially lift up the Crandall family to you, Lord, and pray that your peace be upon them and your healing of their spirit. And Father, we thank you for the ways that you have moved and acted in our life. And Lord, we lift up Carl to you today and just so thankful that he is in remission, Lord, and that you have granted him healing, and we pray that you would heal him still. And Lord, we lift up to you unspoken prayers. And pray, Father, in this time that you would hear the quiet cries of the people gathered here today. We lift up all these prayers in the name of your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we wait for the justice of God to be brought again to this earth, we continue on in hope, and we continue to preach the good news of God's forgiveness and His ultimate deliverance of even the earth itself. But this work of preaching the good news is not done without your help. We need first your prayers. We need your partnership in helping us preach this good news. We also need your tithes and offerings so that this ministry can continue. And if you would like to give to the work here at Cherokee Presbyterian, there are many ways that you can give. We have offering plates on either sides of the door as you leave the sanctuary. And you can also give through Venmo or PayPal, ACH Bank Draft, or through United States Postal Service. We thank you for all the ways that you support the work and the mission here at Cherokee Presbyterian. And now in the thanksgiving of all that God has given us, let us stand and sing together our thanksgiving response. Let us pray. Good and wonderful God, we come to you today and we bring to you our gifts. Father, we pray that you would bless both the gift and the giver, and everything we bring to you would be used to your service, to your glory, and for the proclamation of the good news until your Son returns to us again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we're going to continue standing and say what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. And you can find those words printed in your bulletin. Friends, what is it you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing hymn number 341, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Purchase.
Right, real quick, before we do the benediction, has been told there are some extra cookies. So if you want to talk with Liz or Cecilia, those have an opportunity to buy some more if you would like as you pick others up. So now, friends, go forth in the goodness of our God, trusting in his righteousness and believing in the victory of his divine justice. And now may the blessings of Almighty God grant you the peace of his deliverance. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.